So you've heard about the type of content, how it can be delivered, what we're looking to deliver, but how about we find out what the consumers want? Isn't that a good idea? Well, we can do that for you. We have James Galpin, who is the head of media and digital for Millward Brown, to tell you exactly what the consumers in Latin America actually want delivered and how they want their ads. Welcome to the stage, James.
I should just clarify, although I'm an Englishman and I can't speak much Spanish, I am actually head of media and digital for LatAm. I live in Mexico, so it's not just a foreigner coming in to talk clever about Europe. Okay. Is a clicker handy? Oh, there. Thank you. No worries. So look, I want to talk to you about three things today. A couple of them very briefly and scooted. One, Brandzy LATAM Top 50 was published on Wednesday. If you ever noticed the leaflet in your delegate bags, if you got them, you would have seen the ranking and found out how to get it. Then Ad Reaction 2015, and great to see some highlights from our 2014 study shared with you only a couple of moments ago. This is the 2015 one, just, well, actually preview. It's not published until mid-October, so exclusive preview. And then just a very quick overview of what we're observing about how existing investments are working to build brands in LATAM based on our database of cross-media brand lift studies that we've run in LATAM over the last couple of years. So, firstly, one slide on Brandzy. Top 50 brands in LATAM, just to clarify what those are, brands owned and listed in LATAM markets. So there's a lot of big brands in LATAM that own LATAM brands in the sense that they're not, they don't come from the region, but they still carry a lot of value in the region. But these are the LATAM ones. Almost $132 billion worth of brand value. That's the intangible value that sits in the market values of those businesses that is not explained by their physical assets and products and everything else, yeah? And it's the stuff that grows from a consumer liking and loving a brand more so they buy it more. And it's why investors will pay more for those companies, because they know future sales are secured, because there's a strong brand that means that people will continue to buy it, buy different things, and potentially increase their purchase. And the reason I'm emphasizing all of that is because in Millward Brown, we focus on brand as an outcome, not as just an alternative because we can't get the real outcome that we want to look at sale. No, an outcome that is critical to any business's ability to sell. It's an outcome in and of its own right, and it's important. And it delivers that amongst just 50 LATAM brands. Think of all the other LATAM brands that aren't in the top 50. And then also add on to that the value of Coca-Cola, Apple, you name it, sold in LATAM because of their brands. Brand is an outcome, and it matters. And it's not just about sales response. So enough of that. I'm running out of time. So. Most of what I go through now is just going to be some highlights of the Ad Reaction 2015 study. This year, we focused on video creative in a digital world because a lot of the clients we work for are major TV advertisers, and they believe in the value of video communication because of that TV heritage, but they therefore are really interested in the opportunities that the growing amount of video consumption, video content consumption that is existing in TV and beyond TV offers to them. So we focus this year's study on understanding that space. Ad Reaction this year is a study that we've run across 40 countries amongst over 12,000 multi-screen users. The LATAM markets we've covered, Argentina, Brazil, Mexico, and Colombia. And the results I'm going to show you now are the overall results for LATAM from those four markets. And as I say, this report is not published till mid-October. So this is exclusive preview, very top line, I'm afraid. We were literally pulling the data off over the weekend, or early this week as well, just to get these, but just to give you some highlights of what we're seeing. Firstly, smartphones, yes, this is old news, so this isn't the main point and the main purpose of the study, but smartphones are established as the most used screen for LATAM consumers that have them, yeah? So if you've got a smartphone, you spend more time looking at the smartphone screen than you do any other screen. Found that last year when we were more focused on just general multi-screen usage. But what we're really focused on this year is video usage. So in this study, we went into detail on time spent consuming video or watching video by device. Now, clearly, TV still is, when we're focusing in on video, still the dominant screen, yeah? Live TV accounts for a lot. And then on top of that, there's a whole load of on-demand TV. And let me just clarify what I mean by on-demand in this context. In that on-demand bucket, the 49, is a combination of everything. The new online delivered channels that go into smart TVs and boxes, via, you know, things like Crackle, Netflix and so on. But also a lot of it is still what I would call traditional TV programming, but shifted either in catch-up services or through PVRs. The key thing here is that it's video or TV programming that people are choosing to watch when it suits them, not just taking in the live stream as it's delivered out by the broadcaster. So live TV, traditional linear TV is still big, but there's a growing amount, even within TV, of selective viewing of TV content when it suits the viewer. Yeah? Oh, sorry, I'm going to jump back if it jumps back. Can I go back one slide quickly? Thank you. Just wanted to make the point. But even within that context, smartphones already account for over 20% of video viewing time. So that's a big opportunity, yeah, in terms of time spent consuming video for our client brands to think about how can we communicate around that engaged video viewing environment. They know it's great from TV, so they want to see how they can move across and leverage the opportunity elsewhere. So the main purpose of this study isn't to do hard data. It's a survey we're asking people to give us feedback. The main purpose is to understand what they think and feel about those environments. You can get hard data elsewhere on user numbers and so on. So the first thing we wanted to look at are the top five mindsets when viewing video by device. Yeah? Well, actually, we asked about the 10, 15 different mindsets. These are the top five. This is for live TV. I was looking to be entertained. I can tell you without having the data up there, that is by far the most endorsed reason people are consuming TV content. It's at the top of the list, that's why it's in bold. The other four are all important, but they're nothing like as important as looking to be entertained. But they are, I was relaxed, I was just looking to pass the time. I was looking for something interesting, and I was looking for information. I guess that pays back more to sort of news and sort of documentary type programming. But basically what I would say is it's escapism, yeah? People are just trying to be taken away from the moment to somewhere different, be it a story or be it a place in a sort of travel or an experience, yeah? But it's largely take me away from here right now, yeah? TV does it tremendously well. Question, I'm now gonna show you the same set of top five reasons for laptop, smartphone, and tablet. I'm gonna ask you a question, I want a show of hands if you're willing to do it. Firstly, whether you think the profiles for the other screens will be very similar, or, and then second, we'll show of hands, very different, just overall. I'll show you them individually. But so first, who thinks the profile for other screens is gonna be very similar to TV? Okay, so not that many. I don't know if that's because no one's gonna show hands or because that's a real point of view. We'll find out now. Who thinks it's gonna be very different? Well, there's obviously a lot of you sitting on the fence, but I think marginally more think very different, but it wasn't, a lot of you were not willing to commit. So, there's the answer. Number one, at the top, in bold, because it's clearly far stronger than anything else, looking to be entertained. The hunt for entertainment is a key driver of all video viewing, doesn't matter what device it's on. But interestingly, also, if you look at the things below it, guess what? Four or five are the same as live TV. Yeah? The orders shift around a little bit, but basically, the fingerprint is enormously similar. Yeah? People are looking for the same thing when they're viewing video on a tablet or a mobile as they are when they're watching TV. Context and situation might drive the choice of device, but their mindset is actually very similar. And that should have big lessons for about how we as brands communicate in those environments. I'm not just saying we should deploy the same TV ad, don't misread that, but it's something to know and to think about. And I think the whole thing about sitting forward, leaning back, that applies to certain things you do on a smartphone or a laptop, but it doesn't necessarily apply to video consumption. So don't just translate the device as a single media context. So moving on from that, we wanted to explore advertising receptivity in those environments, just to understand the relationship. So this chart, along the bottom, the opportunity, the scale of the opportunity is the minutes I showed you earlier, yeah, and just how much time spent. But then the really interesting thing on the vertical axis, advertising receptivity when consuming videos in those environments. And live TV is the clear winner here. Yeah, people are far more open and accepting of advertising in TV. Now, I guess that's learned. They've been watching TV for a very long time. They know it's the deal, the transaction. To some of the points made earlier, they don't quite recognize that in other platforms, even if we wish they did. Yeah, and they're resistant to advertising in those video contexts. But there are a couple of things that sit behind this I haven't got charts on. One is that the vast majority of tablet, laptop, smartphone, and on-demand TV is personal individual viewing. It's a one-on-one moment, even on-demand TV, far more so than live TV. Live TV is still a shared experience in the room with the family, majority. Not all, but majority, yeah? So there's a different distraction, perhaps, when you're watching live TV. You might not pay attention to the ad, but you can chat, do what you ever did. And even without your smartphones, people didn't always used to pay attention to the ads. Now they've got smartphones too, yeah? And we wanted to dig a little bit more into that. We also thought there must be some other stuff going on here. So we looked at ad formats, and we asked people what they think about the ad formats when they receive. Bormax is a sort of very rough approximate, given this is survey data, reach claim about which formats they've noticed or experienced recently. And then vertically, the important thing, advertising receptivity. And if you look, there are pairs all across this. So highlight the green one. Dark green, skippable pre-roll. Skippable pre-roll, given we're asking how accepting of advertising, and let's be honest, everyone would rather have things without advertising, let's not kid ourselves, yeah, is actually a pretty good score. That's the people who are positive about receiving it. It's a 5-point scale, there's negativity. Pre-roll, no skip, they really don't like it. And not only is their positive score quite low, I can tell you the negatives are that big. They're nasty, yeah? It actually annoys them. It, excuse my language, pisses them off, yeah? And so we have to be aware of that as marketers. It's a great thing that we force them to watch our ad, except that they hate us for doing it. Doesn't that defeat the object of advertising? So skippability, user control, and permission is key. Every format you'll see, click to play versus autoplay. Click to play wins, autoplay doesn't, yeah? Forcing people to see your ads in their own personal devices, in personal viewing context, they don't like. And they don't like it because they feel it's invading their space. So we also wanted to try and find out, well, what the hell can we do about this in a non-technical way? We can force them. We know we can force them. Right? Technically, it's in our power to do so. But what else can we do? Yeah? And you know, to make them more accepting, but in a slightly less aggressive way. What you see here, and I'm not going to read all these numbers out, you'll see a list of different things that people said endorsed would, you know, make them less likely to skip an ad. And what I want to highlight is that there are three key themes here. Yeah? I should have picked up something from the earlier chart, actually. I'll go back to it in a moment. Finish this first. A lot of those are creative. It's funny or humorous. It's visually appealing and great design, yeah? Features music that is appealing to me. You do a great piece of creative in your advertising, i.e. you make your advertising a great piece of content in its own right, people are far more likely to give you the time of day. Yeah? Something intriguing happens in the first few seconds. That obviously helps a lot with the script. Yeah? The other thing that's really important there is you'll see that clustered together is category that I'm interested in and brand that I'm interested in. Ah, brand's important. You want to sell to me. If I like you as a brand, I will let you sell to me. If I don't like you as a brand, no, you're not even going to get the chance. That's a real difficult one for us, isn't it? We want to do all our clever online sales conversion and response rates, but to get the chance, they've got to like us first. Oh, damn. Got to build brand. Spend money investing on building brand relationships just so they let us sell to them. Consumers, really annoying. The other thing, of course, is we can buy them. We can give them rewards. And can we just skip back to the previous chart very quickly? The orange blob at the bottom, which I forgot to mention. Mobile app, reward. You pay me, I'll watch it. Yeah? Give me a reward, fine. Yeah. So they don't mind if you pay them to watch ads. And, you know, they won't skip if you give them a reason not to skip. In-game rewards or whatever it may be. So there are things that we can do in just the way we deliver, but I would say to, you know, on the evidence of this, you should be careful. We should really accept that we have to give people the opportunity to view or not, then we have to find ways of encouraging them to view. And I accept the content has to be paid for, but if they're going to use ad blockers, which that annoyance drives them to, we're fighting a losing battle. So, and another point I also wanted to raise, we also wanted to explore attitudes towards targeting. So when they're being marketed to an online video, different ways that they can be targeted. So this is their perspective. It's not because they understand the technological underpinnings of how it's happening. It's there when they get the sense that this is happening to them, how accepting are they? They don't mind if they feel they're being targeted because they're getting ads from brands that they like or follow. And it doesn't just mean a like in Facebook, it means they like. Oh, damn, brands again. We've got to make them like our brands so we can advertise to them. Yeah? They don't mind if you put the right brands in front of them. They get irritated when it's a brand that they're not so engaged with or doesn't, they don't feel so relevant to them. Their interests, their pastimes, their hobbies. If you feel like you're targeting them because of something relevant in your in the advertising or marketing communication to their hobby or interest. Ah, that's why you're telling me that. I get it. I'm interested in that. Yeah? Those are the two things that they're really comfortable with. Again, this is a scalar. So as we go down the list, you'll see at the bottom three or four things which are the underpinning of everything we do in digital. And they're hugely powerful. And I know they're great, and we all want to use them. Your online shopping history, your online search history, your web browsing history, your social media profile. And I can promise you there are big negative scores on these as well as the basic positive endorsement. Yeah? They don't really like that. And when they're aware that it's happening, and it can be very transparent. We all know that. I searched for something last week. The next week, all I do is get barraged with ads for that category and that brand or competitor brands, yeah? They know it's happening. They don't like it. They resent it. It feels uncomfortable. So however powerful the technology is, we can really annoy consumers and undermine our brand relationships doing it. I don't have the answer, but it's a tough challenge we've got to overcome as brand marketers, yeah? And as an industry, the digital and media industry have to work out how we cannot build the resistance and dislike to the levels that lead, 26% to have ad blockers already and growing. Yeah? It's our fault. It's not their fault. Yeah? We can't blame the consumer for what we're doing as an industry. Finally, just having finished a quick run through ad reaction. What media are working to build LatAm brands today? So we've done 36 cross-media studies over the last couple of years. This is a research approach we use to understand the brand lift, focused on brand again, impact of multi-channel campaigns. So we're just looking at relative performance in driving brand power, brand strength, yeah? Firstly, just reach, because it's a single source study, so we can at least look at reach across the platform. We can do overlaps, it's all quite nice. But yeah, clearly TV is still the big reach medium. We've got both the global and the LATAM average here, yeah? So yes, no other media on its own can deliver TV's reach. It may be in the future, but you can compile across those media good reach, and they all carry decent reach of their own. But TV's still, you know, in the end, gonna get you more people quicker and easier than most other channels, or all other channels, really. And then this is the global norm of what we've observed. Now, the bottom bar is the share of spend. The others are three components that we know make up brand strength. Yeah, saliency, awareness. Association is sort of imagery and all the things and ideas you have and associations with the brand. And then motivation is sort of preference, consideration, purchase intent type measures. Yeah, and what you'll notice is that perhaps with the exception of saliency, TV slightly underperforms its investment across all those. It's still the biggest driver. It's hugely powerful, but it's also expensive. So other media slightly over-deliver, typically, on most of them anyway, including other traditional media on the impact per dollar invested. So in a simple efficiency argument, globally, the evidence is, you know, that's covering US, North, Europe, and Asia, as well as LATAM. The story is still, TV's great, but it's expensive, and it's not the most efficient, so we need to be thinking of redeploying. This is the LATAM story. Now look, this is exaggerated, so I want to be very clear to the TV people in the room. The story is similar. The basic truth is still there. TV does the biggest amount, and it's going to be incredibly hard to replace that with anything else. But it's expensive. So the other media are very efficient, and particularly we're seeing in LATAM online video and online display working very efficiently. That's probably also a price effect. They're probably still quite cheap inventory because, as an industry, we're not really exploiting those opportunities in LATAM as much as they are being exploited in the rest of the world. So there's probably a pricing effect in there. The other thing that's really important to understand in LATAM, we're tending always to do these studies with a web survey population. So we're looking at the online population. Clearly, in a lot of LATAM markets, that's high. It's the majority, but it might be 60 to 70% of the population, not 80 or 90%. So TV's still working on the people who aren't online. Clearly, online and aren't. Yeah, so we have to be slightly careful. But the story doesn't change. Overall, the pattern is still that, even when you allow for that, that TV is great, but expensive, and in cost efficiency terms, not the most cost efficient media. That's partly because of the way we deploy TV, partly because of what the other media deliver. But certainly at the moment, the learning would be, you know, following on some of the conversations I made earlier, looking to we should be delivering investment across more channels and activating across multiple channels more, and into the new digital channels especially. Yeah. So just to wrap up, what should brand marketers do now? Invest in brand building. It matters. It helps you get the conversions and all the things you want online. It's important. But increase your weight of investment into digital channels. Just remember, you need to look at outcomes beyond behavioral response and sales conversion. Exploit brand communication and opportunities in mobile video. People are spending time there. They're in a similar mindset to TV. There must be a great brand communication opportunity. But we've got to deal with the tendency to resist communications in a personal device and think about more permission-orientated formats. But then we've got to convince people why they shouldn't skip if we allow them to. That means brand, again. And targeting using the least intrusive message possible. And the issue here is if they're aware they're being targeted. If consumers are aware of how you're hunting them down, they don't like it. So you've got to target without being seen to target. And I don't know how, but if we don't, we annoy consumers, and we annoy them by forcing them to view ads, and they put ad blockers on the machines. And it's our fault. That's me. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, James. Okay. Much appreciated. Great insight there. We really enjoyed that. Great insight indeed. Thank you.